Of Luke chapter number 4 in your Bible. Luke chapter number 4 for the closing night of revival meeting. And I want to say thank you for letting me come, Pastor. It's been a great joy and honor to be here these few days, and looking forward to hearing about the blessings of God that I pray will continue to flow to this old-fashioned Baptist church. I appreciate your faithfulness to stay with the old-time way and to stay with the Word of God. You'll never go wrong staying with the old paths. And I intend to do that to the day I die with the help of the Lord. I'll be preaching from Luke chapter number 4 tonight. A lot of condolences I want to give, and I'll do that at the conclusion of the message. I don't like to tarry and keep people waiting for the preaching. Luke chapter number 4, I want to begin reading in verse number 16. And he came to Nazareth, referring to Jesus. Nazareth is where he come from. He's just now beginning his earthly ministry. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up and read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." And that's all he said in his message. And when he got done reading that portion of Scripture, the Bible said in verse 20, and he closed the book. I want you to underline that. I'll be preaching from Luke chapter 4, but that's my text. And he closed the book. After he closed it, he gave it again to the minister. Then when he was sure the minister had that closed book, Jesus sat down. Oh, Lord. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. That'll be all the scripture reading I read for sake of time. I've got a long ways to travel tonight, all night and all morning, and I know you have been faithful to be here every night, and I want to respect the time element. But if you'll read the Gospel of Luke, you'll find that chapter number 1 and chapter number 2 deals with the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is there that the angel of God appeared unto Mary and informed her that she was to be overshadowed with the Spirit of God and would conceive even though she was a virgin. It was a miraculous birth. It was a birth that was sent from above. Matter of fact, it's the only time in the history of man that a birth like this has ever taken place. Jesus is the only begotten Son of God. He is not a Son of God. He is the only begotten Son of God. He's the only virgin-born person that has ever come into this world, Jesus. So in chapter 1 and chapter 2, you find the birth of our Lord. I love to read those chapters because it was when Mary found out she had conceived that she went to Elizabeth, her cousin's house. Elizabeth was 6 months in carrying John, and they stood belly to belly, so to speak, and Mary gave the salutation of the Lord that she had conceived from above. And John the Baptist in his mother's womb, the Bible said, leaped in his mother's womb over this miraculous conception before he was ever born. John did more shouting than most Baptists do in a lifetime before he ever came out of his mother's womb. Some of you deadheads, it'd do you well to say glory every once in a while. And if you're nervous about doing it, stand in front of the mirror at the house and practice for a while. But you ought to get used to saying amen, hallelujah, glory to God. John leaped in his mother's womb when he found out the virgin-born Son of God was on his way to a sin-cursed world. So in chapter 1 and 2, you find the birth of Jesus. In chapter number 3, you find the baptism of Jesus. This is where our Lord walked 40 miles through a desert to be baptized by a Baptist preacher. Now let me throw this in while I'm here. If you get born from above right in chapter 1 and chapter 2, if you have a miraculous birth being born again, you'll have no problem following the Lord in believer's baptism. I worry about this crowd that says they got saved, but they don't want to identify with the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord through baptism. You say, well, I've been baptized Church of God, Church of Christ, water dog, tongue flapper, interdenominational. Let me tell you something. Jesus walked 40 miles to be baptized by the only Baptist preacher that was around. And if it was good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for me. Amen. And I'm telling you, brother, when folks have problem following the Lord in baptism, you trace it back, you'll find out there's something wrong with their birth in chapter 1 and chapter number 2. But in chapter 3, you find the baptism of Jesus. In chapter 4, in the beginning of the chapter, you find the battles of Jesus. Straightway after he was baptized, he went up into the wilderness and was tempted by the devils after he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Let me tell you something. Once you get born right and you submit to believer's baptism to have a clear conscience and the first step of obedience to the grace of God in your life, you better mark her down. The next step is you're going to hit the devil head on. Are you listening to me? Think about this, brother. The Spirit of God descended on Jesus in chapter 3 in the form of a dove, and he goes straight from that experience of being witnessed publicly, of being filled with God, he goes straight from that experience to the wilderness and fighting the demons of hell. Listen, anytime you want to move up closer to God and get the Spirit of God to control you, you mark her down, buddy. You're headed for a mount of temptation, and you're going to hit the devil head on. You say, well, I don't have a problem with the devil. I guess not. Bless God, you're walking the same direction he's in. I tell you, when you get right with God and you walk according to the Lord, you'll hit him head on every once in a while because you're going in different directions. But in chapter number 4, in the first half of this chapter, you find Jesus and his battle. It's there that the Lord defeated the devil 3 times by quoting the word of God. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. That has always brought victory to the child of God. And if it worked for Jesus, it'll work for us. That's why you need to read the word of God. Even if you think you're reading it and you're not getting anything out of it, you still need to read it. Because at the proper time, the Spirit of God is able to put your heart and brain in the reverse. He's able to back it up in the rewind and bring those scriptures to your mind and your remembrance that you read some time ago that can give you victory over the wiles of the devil. So in the first part of chapter number 4, may I say to you, we see Jesus and his battles. Whose kid is that, by the way? Yeah, get that kid to sit down. Thank you. And here in chapter number 4 where I'm preaching tonight, I'm preaching on Jesus and the books. Jesus and the books. Now I want you to notice what he did in the temple in front of all that crowd that was in church. The Bible said in verse number 20, and he closed the book. And he closed the book. Did you know I got to studying that in the Bible dictionary? Did you know that's a terminology that has to do with accounting? Yeah, that's an accounting terminology. You see, I've been in the business world for some time. Started my first business when I was 10 years old, shoveling snow with gas-operated machinery as a 10-year-old boy up in the ghettos of Cleveland. And so I know one thing about accounting is you've got to keep your books balanced. You've got to keep them up to date, and you've got to keep them right. And I've learned that if you ever close something up, if you finally close it up and seal it for good, your deposit has to be more than your deficit. It's got to be in the black. It can't be in the red. Your deposit has to exceed your deficit if you're going to close out the books. And here in chapter number 4, we see Jesus taking the book from the hand of the minister, and he closed it up, and he gave it to him. I was reading that this morning, and it may not do a thing for you, but oh God, I have a Holy Ghost fit, thinking about different books in the life of ministry, in the ministry of Jesus, that only our Lord could close. He's the only one that could close them, because he's the only one that could deposit more than what the deficits had called for. I want to preach tonight for just a few minutes on the subject. Jesus balanced the books. Hallelujah. Jesus balanced the books. Let me show you a few books that our blessed Lord balanced for his glory and for our good, and I'll be done. Number 1, he balanced the book of depravity. He alone was able to shut the book and seal it up because his deposit was more than the deficit. When I'm talking about the book of depravity, I'm talking about the law of God. There are over 1,000 laws of God found in your Bible. But let's stick with just the 10 commandments out of Exodus 20 that is familiar to the most of us here. Not one person in all the world has ever kept the 10 commandments. If they tell you that, they're a liar. A 7-day disadvantage thinks the 10 commandments will get them to heaven, they're liars. It's going to take more than not eating shrimp, bless God, and catfish to get you to heaven when you die. And it's going to take more. They say, well, church is on Saturday. Well, bless God, I'm for having it on Saturday and Sunday. That don't bother me. But I'm telling you, I'm not going to heaven because I keep the law, because nobody has ever been able to keep the law. That's why when God gave Moses those commandments in the Old Testament, that's why they lived for 4,000 years. Nobody could deposit more in it than what it called for, the deficit, because man is a sinner. All men are sinners. And because we're sinners, we could never balance the book. We're all depraved. We're all ungodly. We're all lost. We have all like sheep gone astray. Our righteousness is as filthy rags. There is none righteous, no, not one. There's none that seeketh after God. Nobody is holy. Nobody is righteous. Nobody is clean. Nobody is perfect. And so for 4,000 years, the book of the law stayed open wide. Nobody was able to close it. When God gave Moses the 10 commandments, he wrote them on stone. The reason why God put the 10 commandments on stone is because stone doesn't bend. You either keep them or you break them. And Paul told us in the New Testament, if you break the law in one offense, you're guilty of breaking all the law of God. So we are all transgressors. We are all sinners. None of us have the ability to attain God because none of us can be like God. We're depraved in our humanity, in our conception, in our birth, in our childhood, in our actions, in our decisions. In sin, we were shaped in iniquity. We inherited depravity. It's DNA. You can't get away from it. I don't care what family you come from, how clean they live, how good you are, how moral you might be. You're still a dirty, rotten sinner in the sight of God. You'll never balance the book. You'll never close the book because we're all sinners and we're all ungodly. But I'm glad 2,000 years ago when the Son of God stepped through the crimson walls of a little virgin girl's womb and came into this sin-cursed world, Jesus didn't come to be a sinner. He came to be the Savior. And as a Savior, brother, he had to be without spot and he had to be without blemish. He had to be above reproach. He had to be sinless. He had to be perfect. And the only way that could happen, Brother Mike, is he could not have the blood of Adam. He must have the blood of a sovereign God. And the Bible declares that the blood that flowed through the veins of Jesus was the blood of God himself. Thank God for 33 and a half years. He walked upon the highways and hedges, the lowly, the dirty, the lepers, the outcasts. But he never once transgressed the law of God. He never once broke the commandment of God. He never once grieved the Spirit. He never once disappointed the Father. And thank God when he went to shed his blood on the cross, he took the book of depravity and said, my deposit is better than the deficit. Thank God he lived above sin. Our Savior is the sinless, spotless Lamb of God that shut the book of depravity. He closed the book, man. Woo! What a Savior. Some of you may have heard me tell this, but I was studying Adam in the garden. And I found out that because of Eve, we got in a mess. And some people ask, where would we be without women? We'd be in the Garden of Eden, so shut up. Adam supplied the parts for the first PA system and didn't even know it when God took his rib. Some of you say, henpeck, you won't even laugh. You won't even laugh. But if you read Genesis 3, when God announces the curse upon women and the curse upon Lucifer, his curse upon Adam was unusual. It was not only that he would till the ground with thorns and thistles to contend with, but it was also the fact that Adam would now have to sweat when he worked. According to the scriptures, Adam never broke a sweat in the Garden of Eden. He was not a sinner. He was innocent in the sight of God. He had never transgressed the Lord. And Adam never broke a sweat. It was a perfect climate. Everything was wonderful there. There was no thorns and thistles and briars and weeds. Adam didn't have to labor in the garden like we do now to plant a garden in a field. He never broke a sweat. But when he became a sinner, God said, Adam, while you're out there toiling the ground every day, every time you feel that clear, salty water run down your face, that's me reminding you, you're a sinner. And as a sinner, when you look at those thorns and thistles and briars and weeds, I want to remind you, that's the curse of God on your life and on this land. And everywhere Adam went, when the sweat would boil down his face, that was God reminding him that he was a sinner. But did you know I tried to study the footprints of the Nazarene? I can't find one place in all the Bible where Jesus ever broke a sweat. Think about it. He set out on the bow of the ship at the Sea of Galilee, 104 degrees in the hot Middle East sun, and talked to thousands that were gathered around the seashore. But the Bible never declares that he ever broke a sweat. He went up in the mountains and prayed all night long, but the Bible never said he ever broke a sweat. He laid in the basement of the ship in the hot summer days as it traveled and went to sleep, but the Bible never said he ever broke a sweat. You know why? Jesus wasn't a sinner. Jesus is the Savior. But in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was pouring his soul out before the Father and was presenting himself as a sacrifice for sin, the demons of hell danced around the Garden of Gethsemane and said, buddy, we'll get in the sweat here. And as they danced around the vibrating carcass of our Lord as he was pouring himself out before the Father, the sweat began to come through his brow and his face. And the demons of hell began to chant and said, there it is. He's a sinner. Look at the sweat, buddy. It's about to come out. But instead of it being white, salty solutions such as you and I, brother, the Bible said he sweat as it were great drops of blood. Brother Junior, when that blood came through the pores, that was God telling this world, my son's not a sinner. He's perfect. He's above it. And I'm telling you, thank God, I'm glad 2,000 years ago, Jesus took the book of the law and he balanced it out and deposited more than the deficit and shut up the book of depravity. He shut it up. Hallelujah. He balanced it once and for all. Woo! Number two, I got to hurry. I got to get out of here. He not only shut the book of depravity, but may I say to you, he shut the book of our deficit to God. Jesus shut the book of our deficit to God. Now watch this. Ever since the fall of Adam, God has always supplied a way for man to atone for his sin. Yes, he did. God slew some kind of innocent animal in the garden and clothed Adam and Eve, typifying and signifying that the innocent had to die for the ungodly. But even though those innocent animals shed their blood, it never did redeem Adam back to God. It atoned his sin. The word atonement means it postponed judgment another year. But another year, another sacrifice. Another year, another sacrifice. Millions and millions and millions of innocent animals laid their lives down, all the way from pigeon, turtle, doves, all the way to lambs and rams and bulls. Brother, they laid their life down and shed their blood trying to get rid of this sin debt problem with God. But the Bible's clear to tell us that not one sin had ever been washed away by the blood of bulls and goats, according to the book of Hebrews. Man had a debt toward God that we could not pay. No matter what we did or did not do, we were still did not have the ability to pay our sin debt and get out of the guilt of God. We were all condemned, lost without God and without hope. And brother, every time another year come around, those lambs had to produce an atonement. It was atonement. It was atonement. It was atonement. But the Bible said in the book of Hebrews, Brother Franklin, not one time did a Jew ever go home with a clear conscience when he offered that Old Testament sacrifice? Not one time did he ever go home and open the door and say, thank God, honey, I got forgiven by God today. His conscience could not be clear because his sins were not taken away. His sins and the judgment thereon was only postponed. And because it was the blood of bulls and goats, the book of our deficit to God stayed open. Yes, it did. For 4,000 years, brother, the book was open. And nobody could deposit enough to meet the deficit and close the book. But 2,000 years ago, John was a-preaching by the River Jordan one day. That crowd had been hearing atonement. They'd heard the word atonement for 4,000 years. Those Jews were very well aware of the atonement and the postponement of the judgment of God. But brother, while John was preaching one day in John chapter 1, brother, Jesus came over that Judean hillside. Had John said something that no Jewish prophet had ever preached before in their history? John said, "Behold the Lamb of God." They were very familiar with that terminology, the Lamb of God. They said, "Yeah, here comes another atonement. Here comes another year. Here comes another rollback. Here comes another postponing." But John looked up and said, "Behold the Lamb of God." Now watch this. "That taketh away the sin of the world." Hey, brother, that crowd had never heard that before. There had never been a lamb able to take the sin away. There was never a lamb able to balance the book. Oh, but bless his holy name. On a bloody hillside 2,000 years ago, when Jesus shed his blood, it satisfied God. And he closed the book. Hallelujah. I want to say to you, friend, Jesus balanced the book. Woo! Jesus balanced the books. Hallelujah to God. It's not what we have done. It's not what we've accomplished. It's what Jesus did on the cross. The Bible said God saw the travail of his soul and was satisfied. Woo! You know, in the Old Testament, in the tabernacle between the holies and the holiest of holies, there was a veil. The veil was 16 inches thick. It was hand woven by the women of Israel. 16 inches thick. It hung from the top of the tabernacle to the bottom. Behind that veil was the mercy seat and the Ark of the Covenant. It was the only place in all the world you could find the Shekinah glory of God was behind that veil. That's why it was 16 inches thick. The Shekinah glory was so bright and illuminating it would blind you. And only the priest could go behind that veil. And he could only go once a year. And if he went without the blood of those lambs and he didn't sprinkle it 7 times on that mercy seat, he had a rope around him. They drug his dead tail out of there. God killed him. He had a pomegranate and a veil around the bottom of his robe, spaced each one apart. And as long as they heard those bells a-ringing and hitting them pomegranates, they knew God had accepted that sacrifice. And all those Jews could do was stand outside and look through that tabernacle and say, "Man, I wonder what it'd be like to get behind that veil." We can't get behind the veil. We're sinners. The book's open. We can't deposit enough to balance the book. And for 4,000 years, all the Jews could do was stand in the outer court and let one man go behind the veil and do the priest's work. But what a lot of people don't know, Brother Franklin, was on the front of that veil was two cherubims. Those cherubims were hand-embroidered on that curtain that hung in the tabernacle. If you'll use the first mention principle, the first time you find a cherubim in the Bible is in the Garden of Eden. He's got a flaming sword and he's driving Adam and Eve out of the garden because they're sinners. The first time a cherubim is ever seen by a human, it's God saying, "You're a sinner. You're excommunicated. You are now separated from me." And the cherubim drove him out of the Garden of Eden. So every time those Jews would look underneath that veil and try to look in that tabernacle, all they could see was two large cherubims embroidered on that veil. That was God saying to them, "You're a sinner. Get out of here. You can't come behind the veil. The book's never been balanced. The blood you've just offered's not good enough. It will atone for your sin, but it'll never bring you in relationship and fellowship with me." And all they could do is stand out there and look at those cherubims. And brother, them cherubims telling them, "Stay away. There's a holy God behind here that'll kill you." But when Jesus shed his blood and died on the cross 2,000 years ago, the Bible said the earth went dark. The rocks were rent. This whole earth trembled with an earthquake. And here's what the Bible said. The veil in the temple was rent from top to bottom. Had the veil been rent from bottom to top, That would have been the deeds of man. But brother, when that 16-inch veil was hung up in that tabernacle, they had hooked 32 oxen to it and pulled it till they were exhausted. Then they held it up in the sunlight to make sure that none of the raveling had come undone. I say to you, brother Watts, when that veil was hung in the temple, the strength of 32 oxen could not pull that veil apart. But when Jesus shed his blood on the cross, two hands reached down out of heaven, much stronger than 32 oxen, and got a hold of the middle of that veil and tore it apart. And brother, when he did, one cherubim went that way, and one cherubim went that way. And now, because the books are balanced, whosoever will, hallelujah to God, we don't need another sacrifice. We don't need another priest. Oh, the book's been balanced. Hallelujah to God. He balanced the books when it comes to the depths of our sin. Number three, God, y'all are killing me tonight. Woo! These non-filtered cigarettes are going to be the death of me. Number three, he balanced the book of death. He balanced the book of death. May I say to you, after Christ bowed his head on a lifeless chest and died, they took him down from the cross and put him in a borrowed tomb. The only thing Jesus ever borrowed in his life was a grave. And he gave it back 3 days later. You know, and the Bible is clear that no man had ever laid in that grave. From the womb to the tomb, everything Jesus was around was clean. Untouched by man. And they laid him in the tomb. Nobody had ever closed the book of death. Some had tried. Some have even been raised only to die again. But nobody had been raised to live forevermore. But on that third glorious day when he lies silent in the tomb, Mr. Death hovering over Jesus, breathing the icy breath of eternity into his face, his long slender fingers around the neck of our Lord, all of a sudden in comes a breeze from another land. And brother, I tell you, the Son of God sat up and came out of that grave. And by the way, the stone wasn't rolled away, buddy, to let Jesus out. It was rolled away to let the disciples in. I tell you, brother, when he got up, resurrected with that glorified body, brother Death was sitting over there holding his head with both his eyes black, and brother sitting there with a key ring, but the keys were gone. I said, his keys are gone. His keys are gone. I'm telling you, brother, when Jesus got up, he took the keys to death and hell, and he told John in the book of Revelation, said, you'd better tell the devil where the keys to death are, or they're going to die prematurely. You tell him, I said, I've got the keys to death and hell. I'm in charge of this thing. I paid the debt. I balanced the books. I closed the books. I've got victory over death. Hallelujah. He closed the book of death. Hallelujah. I got to close. I'm out of time and breath. And one day, because he did, some glad morning when we wake up, we'll turn around and look at the grave and said, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Did you know death has a stinger? I was listening to a editorial about bees the other day. And there's an African bee trying to come over to the States. Ain't nothing ever come over from over there. That caused us trouble. Talking about insect world. And don't look at me like that. I said the insect world. You know, cockroaches come from Africa? That's exactly right. That's where they came from. And so, look up here, Brother Watts. We'll talk about the insect world. There's a branch of bees in Africa that's multiplying so fast they can't keep up with it. It's taking over the jungles over there. And they literally showed this bee inserting its stinger into human flesh. And what I didn't know was, is on the end of that stinger is a barb facing the other way. So when that bee stings you, he wants to pull it back out, but that barb gets hung under the skin. And when he pulls it out, instead of the stinger coming back out, it pulls his tail off. And in that fragment of the tail that comes off with that barb and that stinger is poison. And that's why some people have reactions and they swell and they have to get shots. But he said, there's one thing I always want you to know. You can only be stung by that thing one time. And once it loses its stinger, it's lost it forever. Son, I tell you, I believe Mr. Death came in and put that stinger in Jesus and said, if there's ever one I got to hold, I'm putting my stinger in this one. This is the one I got to put it in. But when Jesus got up on resurrection morning, you know what he said? I've taken the sting out of death. He pulled his tail off, if I can put it that way. He pulled his tail off. Hey, there ain't no use to worry about dying. He don't even have a tail anymore. Woo! Don't worry about death. He ain't even got a tail. Yeah. Number four. Not only balanced the books of death. I got to get out of here. He balanced the book of doubt. He closed it. His deposit against doubt was more than a deficit. It's called the Lamb's Book of Life. It's a book. And everybody that's ever been saved, their name's sealed in that book. If I read the book properly, Revelation chapter 5 said it's got seven seals on it. Jesus sealed the Book of Life that your name is in seven times. I know the Book of Life, Lamb's Book of Life is in heaven. Because it'll be manifested at the great white throne judgment in Revelation chapter 20, verse 11 through 15. And whosoever is not found written in the book of life will be cast into the lake of fire. I believe the tabernacle on earth was a shadow of the tabernacles in heaven. That's what the book of Hebrews says. You can't have a shadow unless you have a substance first. So just like there was a shadow of the tabernacle on earth, there's a substance of a real tabernacle in heaven. Jesus died as our lamb, our sacrifice, but he was raised as our great high priest, according to the book of Hebrews. I believe he got the blood that he shed on the cross 3 days earlier, went past the angelic choir, waved good morning to the Father, and walked in the tabernacle in the glory world. I believe he put the blood on the mercy seat of God and opened up a way for whosoever will to come and be forgiven and be saved, be brought back into communion and relationship and fellowship with God. And I believe right where the Aaron's rod that budded the Ten Commandments and the bowl of manna, I believe the Lamb's Book of Life is on the mercy seat in the Ark of the Covenant. And the only way you're going to get to that book is to come through the blood that Jesus shed on the cross. And if the devil could take our name out and try to get to that book that Jesus balanced with our name in it, he'd have to go through the blood. And if he went through the blood, he'd be a saved devil and he wouldn't want to get our name out anymore anyhow. I'm telling you, Jesus balanced the book of doubt. I don't have to worry about if I'm saved today, lost tomorrow. I don't hope so, think so, maybe so. I've been sealed. Let me tell you what the Bible said. The Bible said that God has given us the earnest of the inheritance. He's given us the person of the Holy Ghost to live inside us. He is a seal. The Bible said we are sealed unto the day of redemption. We cannot be opened up. We are sealed. That book's got seven seals of God on it. Think about it. I'm safe and secure, and I don't have to worry about if I'm saved or not. Sealed. Think about this, and I'm done. My oldest son works for the post office in Kingston, Tennessee. He runs that post office there. And one thing Philip will tell you, when you take a letter and you put something in it, a name, a letter, a note, or whatever, a check, once you seal it and put the stamp on it, nobody, once it's in the process of going from one destination to another, once it begins that process, nobody has the authority to open it up until it reaches its final destination. Once it's sealed and stamped, it cannot be opened up until it reaches its final destination. When God saved you, he put the Spirit of God in you, folded you over and sealed you and stamped you, heaven bound with a hammer down. And it cannot be opened up until I reach my final destination. You cannot stop it. I'm in a process, honey. I started here, but I've been sealed instead. And when they open it up, I'll be up. Hallelujah. Jesus balanced the books. Let's stand with our heads bowed and our eyes are closed. Father, I love you.